thought.
The work actually, all the work in here kind of were produced in three different countries. Initially, the drawings behind me were produced at a residency I was invited to in Oaxaca. And the second body of work was produced in China, which are the ceramic pieces. And then all the pieces on paper were produced in Boston, as well as Provincetown, Massachusetts. And most of my work kind of takes me back to the kind of traditional art making. Rather than using a pencil, I use a knife to draw lines on a flat piece of plane, which is paper. What I do is that I slice the difference between the lines, and then I pull them apart and pull them into physical space. Some of my influence in the work, very often I kind of try to use location as an inspiration. And when I travel, I try to pick up different ideas from different locations. I try to somehow integrate those kind of drawings into shapes and forms into my paper cut, and then into my drawings and prints. And if you guys ever seen any woodblock prints, you'll see that the heavy image is made out of a image that's either cut away or left behind. And what I'm doing is essentially doing the same thing, except I go one more step. I pull them into a three-dimensional space. And certain things that are important to me tend to be of a cultural identification. And some of them have to do with Buddhism, and some of them have to do with Taoism. But what I am is someone that follow the philosophy which they provide. And a lot of the work here actually stem from thinking about those things. A lot of my work artistically kind of follows a certain type of tradition as well. But in terms of the composition and how it's laid out, you'll notice that this piece kind of looked like that piece right there, right? And looks like that piece right there. And it's not an accident the way they look. And also, you'll notice that some of the drawings kind of have this kind of verticality to it. And the genesis to that is actually kind of borrowing from traditional Chinese scroll paintings. In China, during the Song Dynasty, there's a genre of painting called monumental painting, and the hallmark of these paintings are essentially the verticality of the composition and also the monumentality of the rocks. And in some ways, those paintings are about Taoism. If you think about this as a scroll painting with that window and the screen as the background of the scroll, and that's the kind of thing that I was trying to create in this particular space. Essentially, I have been trying to make the work specifically for this particular space. Basically, it's that notion that the experience you have is—it's always a unique experience, regardless how many times you do it. And Sisyphus, who was doomed to push a rock up the mountain for eternity, and some people think it's a banishment, and other people think he has eternal life, try to make perfection of a very simple task, and each time he does it, it's different. When I recreate this, it goes right back to all the things that I think about in terms of impermanence, the temporariness of who we are, and that versus the kind of a grander timeline of the landscape. there are certain rules I give myself, and it's, you know, we all live in limitations, and one of the limitations that I tend to give myself prior to this piece is that it should have a central axis and a single line. It has to support itself. So when I was in doing the residency in Oaxaca, and like other residencies I have done, is I always try to incorporate local material and ideas into my art. Because initially I brought my own material and it didn't work. And then I walked around the city and discovered gold, this paper. And it wasn't until I discovered this paper, everything conceptually came together for me, because you know, for a Chinese person being in Mexico, try to make a connection there, it's not impossible, because they actually have a very good Chinese restaurant. And one of the things that dawned to me when I went to this mountain, this sacred mountain, which it's been a sacred place for almost 3,000-4,000 years, I realized the connection from that region to who I am has to do with history. And historically, it has to do with this, is that during the Ming Dynasty, the Europeans were using that region to mine silver and gold. The question is, what did they need all that gold and silver for? And the answer was that they were using gold and silver to pay for silk, ceramics, and tea from China. Literally, the Europeans were plucking the raw material, shipping to Philippines, and then trading with Chinese for the products China was making. The only thing Europeans could offer was gold and silver. And that essentially was the clicking point for me. It's like that was a perfect scenario for me. The discovering of this paper actually was somewhat of a miracle, because it has a certain quality. It exists in the space where it's just bit less than impossible for me to cut. And when I put it up, it's easy to hold its shape and create kind of a natural form without being too heavy. So that, yeah, that's kind of interesting, because growing up in during the Cultural Revolution, you would think that we're all kind of beaten into kind of conformism, right? But some of the greatest Chinese artists came out of that period. Xu Bing, who is shown here, he's only a few years older than me. And also, ironically, during Margaret Thatcher's period in England, where she starved the arts, some of the greatest British artists came out of that period. If you think about Bonnard, French artist, who joined World War II, hid himself in his studio, made some of the greatest painting of that period. So artists will always find a way to make art. It's in our genes. It's the thing that define and make meaning for us. I'm part of the stream. We are defined by a lot of different things. So I think, I do think that it is in a privilege to be an artist. And when I had a show, my first show in ICA, I did the paper cut, which covered a huge part of the gallery, but it was predominantly flat. And for me, it's almost like trying to figure out how to create this kind of a natural flowing form using paper after having cut the lines, having exist on a flat plane, and then, you know, and yet trying to also speak back into the notion of two-dimensional space, which in Stella's work, he's trying to use Baroque paintings as a space that kind of emulates from the plane forward, which you probably seen in Caravaggio's work, where in the Entombment of Christ, he's trying to position the viewer in the tomb in that very specific moment in Western history, where paintings, rather than receiving back into a visual space of the plane, of the paper, or the canvas, Caravaggio moved it forward. So Frank Stella actually continued with that tradition in the late 70s and early 80s, even till nowadays, that talking about that Baroque space which bounces forward. And I'm trying to use that in conjunction with the three-dimensional, I don't even know what to call this, three-dimensional thing, and then the two-dimensional drawings.
You're terrific.
Thank you very much.